I'm Heather Gallion, and welcome to Peaceworks. In this episode, we're going to hear from Bruxy Cavey, and we asked some people the following question. Do you think Jesus would agree with the Old Testament law, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth?
I don't think so. I think that it's more like if you, like he said, if someone hits you on the left cheek, you know, turn your right cheek, that's more accurate than an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. So I think an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth more means like something like, it feels like revenge. It feels like kind of like, you did this to me, so I'm going to do this to you. You're not taking it. You're not being loving. You're being revengeful. So I don't think Jesus would agree with that.
I don't think so, no. Like, Jesus sees everybody equally, and he forgives everyone for what they've done. So by practicing that statement, it just would be counteracting all of his preaching that he's done in, like, the New Testament, and really just going against what people should be doing, like, which is loving your neighbor as yourself.
I think that Jesus understood the historical meaning of the law, and also recognized that he was the fulfillment of the law, and that he was brought to bring a new way and a new law.
Let's see what some other people had to say.
When a Christian holds a gun and points it at someone else, from the standpoint of Christ, there's really only two kinds of people on the planet we have the opportunity to kill, a Christian or a non-Christian, someone who's on their way to heaven, someone who's on their way to hell, someone who belongs to the kingdom of Christ, and someone who does not. In that moment, we have to ask the question, what does the scripture say is our choice? If it's a Christian at the other end of the gun, the scripture seems quite clear. We are two people who actually belong to the same kingdom. We're on the same side, and even though our earthly kingdoms have told us we're to go to war, We are part of a kingdom that transcends any earthly nation. We are brothers, we are family, we are soldiers of Christ in his kingdom. We're not to kill each other, we're to lay down our arms and demonstrate a miraculous transnational unity that only the cross of Christ can create. That's our calling in that moment. And so we lay down our arms and we walk toward our brother to embrace him. Of course, if he doesn't believe the same way, he'll probably shoot us. And we'll die, but we'll die in obedience to Christ instead of in rebellion to Christ. If the other person is a non-Christian, then the scripture is clear on what our response is to be, because here is someone who more than anything, they need the gospel. Here is someone who we are to be willing to lay down our lives, to die for a cause if necessary, in order to give them every possible opportunity to say yes to Christ. And if we were to pull the trigger, we would be saying in this moment, I now remove that opportunity from you forever. In this moment, I decide not to give you the gospel, but to give you a bullet. In this moment, I say, quite literally, go to hell. And of course, the scripture's clear. That's not acceptable. We are to give everything, including, if need be, our life, in order to give this person every possible chance to receive Christ. If they kill us, we'll go to heaven. That's a much better end to the scenario than us killing them. And so we can't pull the trigger. We put down our gun and we walk toward them to share the gospel, and if they don't believe the same as us, they'll probably shoot us. And we'll die in obedience to Christ. You see, this is why Christians make lousy soldiers. Or at least we should. Because there's nobody left that I can think of, no third category that we can actually kill. Among evangelicals, a just war theory is the dominant view without question. And in fact, most don't question at all. It is just simply assumed. It is such the dominant view that it is quite possible to grow up in the church. And many of you have already reported this experience to me. Grown up within the church, attended all the Bible studies and all the services and done your homework and still never even heard the point of view that's being represented in this series. Because the just war theory is just assumed by so many within the evangelical camp. And so we want to take this morning to say, all right then, let's give the other side a fair shake. Let's at least try to understand it, even if we know up front we don't agree with it. Let's try and understand how they could get to that point. And so we want to look at the biblical evidence for the just war theory. Are you ready to go? Here we go. Insert the sound of crickets here. It just isn't there. There is no just war theory in the Bible. There just isn't. But wait a second, you say, isn't there war in the Bible? Oh yeah, there's war in the Bible. In the Old Testament, there's war, but it's not just war, it's holy war. And there's a difference. Holy war is initiated by God. It's commanded directly by God, and it is usually for the purpose of punishing an entire group of people. It does not distinguish between civilians and combatants. It is designed to punish an entire nation at a time, and so men, women, and children are called to be exterminated, often including cattle. This is not just war. This is unjust war, unless there is a God behind it who knows that this is about punishment of an entire people group. If holy war is not true, if there is not a God behind it, then this is not just war, it's unjust war. You can't turn to the Old Testament as your model for just war. Well, what about the New Testament? Well, in the New Testament, we're engaged in a spiritual battle against a spiritual force. People are not the enemy, they are victims of the enemy. And we are all soldiers at arms in that sense in a spiritual battle for a spiritual kingdom against the dark forces of this world, but not against people. And our weapons of war are not carnal. They are not physical. And this is very clear. There's just no just war in the Bible. There's spiritual war in the New Testament. There's holy war in the Old Testament. There is not just war. So we have to ask the question, where does this come from then? How can the dominant view within the Christian church be the view of just war? Before we dive into it, let me remind you of something we said the first of the series. We are well aware that there will be people listening to this at one of our sites at the meeting house or listening via podcast who disagree with our position holding to peace theology and who subscribe to just war thinking. And so this morning, as we unpack this, it'll feel close to home. You'll say, come on, you're taking a shot at what I believe. And we are. We're not taking a shot at you, though, and we want to again acknowledge that we want to trust each other's hearts and say that we believe that it's quite possible to hold different points of view and have a good heart about it. We believe it's quite possible for brothers and sisters in Christ to have a different opinion, and we can still honor one another. We can believe the best about each other and say, I will trust, unless you give me evidence otherwise, that you have done due diligence, you have studied the scriptures, and in some way you're able to articulate, you have come to a different conclusion. I can trust that you have processed it through in prayer with God and that your conscience has also aligned with your understanding of Scripture to come to a different conclusion. I believe that that's possible, and there are many within our community who will land the plane in a different runway than we will on this topic, and we will go on being brothers and sisters together, and we will challenge one another. As iron sharpens iron, we will have friction with each other, but it will be loving friction. But we will continue to do our best to call us back to the teachings of Christ and to live that out. And so if you are someone who holds to the beliefs we're going to be taking a critical look at this morning, you're among friends, you're not the enemy, and if you were, we'd have to love you anyway. Now, most Christians who hold to just war theology have never thought it through to the extent we're going to talk about this morning. As we look at it in some systematic and organized way, we have to admit that most evangelicals who hold to this actually have not worked it through in an organized and systematic way. They just have always assumed it to be true. Christians just assume, well, of course there's scenarios where I would make sure that I use force to defend, whether it's my family or my country or whatever. Of course there's scenarios where sometimes you just have to kill. They haven't thought it through. It's just assumed. And that sometimes is the power of the system. The power of the belief is that it is not regularly trotted out and placed on the table for scrutiny. It's just kind of assumed by everyone. And so it's hard to actually debate with when it has such deep, deep blinding assumptions as its root system. But let's bring it out for examination and see what just war actually is. And we got to ask the question, how did we get there? First of all, just war in general can be divided into six principles. Those who have fashioned the just war theory look for some principles in Scripture. You can see these values here, the value of submission. We should be in submission to higher authorities, such as government. We should always seek for justice for the oppressed. We should always act out of love, not out of selfish ambition. We should always practice patience and not run headlong into battle unnecessarily. We should be reasonable about the outcome and whether it is wise to go into war. And we should always respect all people as made in the image of God, including the combatants that we are fighting against. Here are some principles. How do just war theorists apply these principles to craft their position? Well, you have them in your notes, and we can put them up on the screen. Let's take a look at this. First of all, point number one, legitimate authority. An established government must call for the war. The citizenry as a whole is not able to rise up and go to war. It must be a legitimate authority. According to the Catholics, that needed to be a national authority, so you could have nation fighting against nation. No other legitimate authority could call for a war. The Protestants under Calvin argued that you could have a lesser legitimate authority call for war against a superior legitimate authority. In other words, you could have a province go to war against the nation, or a state go to war against the nation. And so because many of the American Puritans were Calvinists, they then felt that if they were Catholics, they wouldn't go to war against their own nation, that is Britain, but because they were able to go to war as a lesser authority, calling themselves now as their own government, they had a Protestant rationale for going to war against Britain. At the time, about a third of Americans were believed in the rebellion, about a third were loyalists, and about a third didn't care. But it was primarily motivated by the Protestant innovation of saying a legitimate lesser authority can call for war against a legitimate higher authority. Next, just cause. There must be a justified reason for going to war against an intentional enemy aggression. We can't go to war just because we want to gain land or for personal reasons. Thirdly, there needs to be right intention. Just because there is a just cause, we have to be honest in our hearts about our intention to live up to that just cause. We can't use the just cause as our excuse, but then just go to war because we want to plunder or because we don't like a particular people. So then number four, there must be a last resort. War must be the last resort. In other words, we only get to war after we have given ample warning to allow the enemy to step back, to step down, There must be opportunity for negotiations to run their course and be exhausted before we would arrive at war. Number five, probability of success. You see, martyrdom is not a value in just war. It is a value in holy war. To die for the cause is a worthy goal within holy war. It's not the goal. It's possible within just war, but it's not the goal. And this is one of the problems today in the West fighting against Islamic extremism. They're fighting a holy war, and we're fighting a just war. And then lastly, number six, legitimate means, distinguishing between combatants and civilians. Jesus was a pacifist. The early Christians were pacifists. All the New Testament writers are pacifists. And for the first 300 years of church history, all Christian leaders and writers are unanimous on this topic. They are all pacifists. And not only pacifists saying that Christians should not fight, but they write, the church fathers write unanimously whenever they become aware of a Christian in the military or in government, they are unanimous in their voice to write to them and call for them to resign, to step away. You are not to be involved not only in the military, but in the government where you may oversee the military or where you are simply overseeing legislation and you are using force, a different kind of force, that is legislation, to try and bring about the Christian ethic. That's not the way of Christ. The way of Christ is to win over hearts from the inside out and to serve from the bottom up, not to bring about morality through legislation from the top down or the outside in. And so for the first 300 years, unanimously, the church leaders and the church fathers write to say, resign, step away. Do not be involved in the military. Do not be involved in the government. And then, Constantine, the one who holds authority over all of the military and all of the government himself, says, but I'm a Christian. What do you say to me? And what do they say? For the bishops say, well, craft another resignation letter. Tell him he should step down. If he's going to be a Christian, he needs to resign from being emperor, obviously. It's a possibility, but hold on a second. Before you write that letter to Constantine, think about this. He says God actually appeared to him, that he heard a voice, that he had a vision. It seems as though supernatural powers were inspiring him and a part of his victories. We have to consider that seriously. And also, he's alleviated the persecution for the first time in a long time. And we're just recovering from one of the fiercest waves of persecution ever under Diocletian. And now Constantine is lifting that and making it possible not only for us not to be persecuted, but for us to openly declare the gospel to people. This is good news for the kingdom. And not only that, Constantine is funding the production, the copying of more Bibles and helping us establish churches. And he is protecting our rights to proclaim the gospel everywhere. Wait a second. Why would we ask Constantine to step down and step away from office? Maybe God is using him to bring about his kingdom on earth. Doesn't Revelation say that one day heaven will come down to earth and there'll be a new heaven and a new earth? Maybe that's happening now. Maybe through Constantine and through the Holy Roman Empire, God's kingdom is coming to earth. And if the rest of the world is taking its time to finally come under the authority of that kingdom, then it would be appropriate for this new kingdom to use warfare to help spread the kingdom of Christ. Hey, guys, we need to rethink everything. Now, what's interesting is notice that the mentality of the just war worldview did not come from further scripture study. It is not that theologians said, wait a second, there's a whole bunch of stuff here in the Bible that we haven't really acknowledged before we need to deal with. It came from experience, from a change of circumstances, and them being motivated to somehow explain the change of circumstances. And so they either said, Constantine, if you truly are a Christian, you need to resign, or they said, Constantine, maybe God is using you in power, and if so, we need to rethink everything. And that's what they chose. And they rethought everything. Now, it did mean that what they had been convinced of for 300 years was plain in Scripture, they had to go back to and reassess. They had to begin. Some of the most brilliant minds were brought to bear to say, if God is bringing about his kingdom through force, even though Jesus seemed to teach against it, but if God is doing it, I mean, we see the evidence, then how do we reassess what we find in the Scriptures? And so we see amazing minds coming to bear to try and rethink through what Jesus taught plainly in the Sermon on the Mount. Because after all, Jesus can't want all Christians to live this out, can he? I mean, he certainly can't want Constantine to live it out. If Constantine were to live like Jesus, that would make him a pacifist. And how long do you think a pacifist emperor would survive in Rome? How long do you think he'd be emperor before somebody assassinated him once they found out he doesn't believe in self-defense? And if his way of Christianizing the state became true and the majority of people became Christians, how long do you think the Holy Roman Empire would last? Let's take it to an extreme. Suppose, hypothetically, there was a whole nation of Jesuses. It's Jesus land. It's Jesus on a national scale, an entire country of Jesuses. How long do you think that country would last? What would be the history of that country? It would be brief. In a violent, fallen world like us, maybe the country would act as a prophetic loud voice, a testament to the light of God and to the love of God. The country would try and serve the needs of others, and the country would speak the truth in love, but the country wouldn't last long before it was invaded, and the country collectively would die. All Christians are called saints in the New Testament. They began to divide a separate class of uber Christian called saints or disciples. There's the regular Christian, because I'm just a member of this new Christian nation now, this new Christian society. I'm a regular Christian. But then there's the uber Christians, and we'll create places for the uber Christians to go and to live. We'll call them monasteries, and we'll have monks, and we'll have nuns, and they will go and they will live out the Sermon on the Mount on our behalf, and we will cheer for them. And we will say, way to go. You remind us all that the love ethic of Jesus is a beautiful thing. And so a certain class of Christian is called to live out the Sermon on the Mount, but certainly Jesus didn't mean that for every regular Christian. Then later the Protestants brought in some innovation. They said, well, maybe the Sermon on the Mount is designed to function the same way we believe the Old Testament law was designed to function. Based on the teaching of Paul, Martin Luther said that the Sermon on the Mount may be just like the Old Testament law. It sets the standard so high, no one can actually live it out. It's actually there in order to increase our guilt. It's there to show us that God's standard of holiness is so high that we are sinners in need of a Savior. We need to fall on the mercy of God. We need to repent and ask for His grace. The Sermon on the Mount is just a new form of Old Testament law designed to make us aware of our need for grace. Some liberal theologians said, no, I think Jesus meant what he said, and he said what he meant, and he called all of his followers to live this way. But, of course, when we read Jesus, we realize he thought the end of the world was going to come within a couple of years. When we read the writings of Paul, we think Paul thought the end of the world was going to come within a couple of years, maybe a decade at most. And so, of course, Jesus and Paul and the apostles were teaching a very radical love ethic for everyone to participate in, and they meant it to the radical extreme they were teaching it, but that's because they thought any day now Jesus is going to return and the world is going to come to an end and the apocalypse will happen. And of course, Jesus got it wrong, Paul got it wrong, and so now we know more than they did, and we realize you can't live by that today. That was for then, it's not for now. Evangelicals tend to not have a well-worked-out theory on why they reject the teaching, they just do. Typically, we'll say, well, Jesus said this. They'll say, yeah, but he didn't actually mean that. You say, well, what do you think he meant? Well, in some cases, you just have to. You say, okay, but I'm just asking you scripturally, what do you mean? Can you show me from Scripture what? Well, listen, suppose a guy breaks into your house and, I know that, but just from Scripture, can you? Well, look, what about Hitler? He was going, I know. Can you just tell me from Scripture? And what's fascinating is the people who pound the Bible the most and say everything has to come back to the Bible when it comes to this topic, put the Bible aside and look everywhere else to try and figure out what truth is.
If there's any other way. first went, I was dressed in wine. If you had a part of me, will you take your time? Even if I come back, even if I die, is there some